This is so good. You know, this is like a family on top of family. You know what I mean? We got some people who have traveled many miles to be with us here this weekend, and we appreciate all that effort. If you have your Bibles, like where you turn with me to Proverbs, the 18th chapter. You know, a lot of wisdom is found in the Proverbs, and in this one chapter, there's a lot of it. How many's ever quoted the scripture, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower"?
That's right.
It's in here. That's a good one, right?
Right.
Oh, the righteous run into it, and they're safe.
Amen.
Woo! That's good. How many's ever heard "the power of life and death is in the tongue"?
Right.
That's in here too. That sounds like some good stuff, doesn't it?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Or, "whosoever findeth a wife findeth a good thing."
Woo!
Yeah, it's a good wife. There's a qualification there. It's got to be a good wife. Because it's better to dwell on the rooftop than in the house. Well, never mind. That's not in this book. But it's in there. It's in there. It's crazy. Or there's even one there that says, "For a man to have friends, he must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother."
Amen. That's right.
Isn't that wonderful scripture? Well, I'm not going to use any of those. I'm here to announce the beginning of a brand new motorcycle ministry called Brothers Offended. And the initials are B.O. Forever, Forever B.O. You know how I like those initials. That's better than the offended few, isn't it? I couldn't help myself. The Bible says here in the 18th chapter of Proverbs, 19th verse, that a brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city. And their contentions are like the bars of a castle. I want you to let that sink in as we begin to talk about this scripture, because it's basically where we all live. And I've got a lesson for the church, and I got a lesson for the bikers. So just let the Lord, you know, have His way and speak to your heart. And I'll open myself up and try to be as transparent as possible. And if I say something that hurts your feelings,
get over it.
Your feelings might not be where they should be. Right. And if it's honest, then come to me later. I'll fix it. Maybe. Hard work. It's hard work winning someone back who you offended. I look around and I see, you know, and this is the thing about it is, I had a guy come from the neighborhood one time, and he came to this door and he said, "Is this the church that allows bikers to come?" And I was like, "Are the churches that don't allow bikers to come?" You know, and apparently that was the consensus that he thought that. And I think we even feed into it a little bit. You could probably find a patch in here that says, "These are my church clothes." You know, on the vest with the leather, right? Has anybody got that patch? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I told you, you fell right in there. You fell right in there. And what? And you know what? You look, and sometimes bikers can be intimidating looking. All the kids were always afraid to go to Sister Shelley's dad's house. But if you ever saw him feed the squirrels and the hummingbirds, then you wouldn't be as afraid. You know what I mean? Got that big look going on, but inside it's just big babies with big toys. I said, "Brother Scott, aren't you afraid?" "No, I pack too, so don't." You know, they make it because they're guns. You know, if they have a gun, that makes me intimidated. No, they don't make me intimidated. I'm not going to be intimidated. You know, but it is. I mean, look at Paul. Look at that. He's a good example. Look.
Come on, brother.
Paul, why don't you say a few words?
Thank you.
here, son. This ain't no cakewalk. But it's true. And what I mean by that is, you know, we got the biker ministry, but I can't say I haven't experienced it myself, because I have experienced myself. And the first thing that it runs to when I get offended, or when I used to get offended, was, I'll just start my own. Right? I can remember, now get this, and sometimes it's just fate and the way things go. I remember when I first joined the motorcycle ministry, it was in Z-Man's backyard. I met Barry Mason there, and he asked me to become a part of his ministry. It made me feel very special, and I got the patch and all. And then we were there on another day, and Z-Man was getting a full leather back patch of our original patch. You know, this big, no flag stuff. You know, just this big leather patch that said, Heaven Saints, Jesus is Lord, with our little armor bearer in the middle. And it was awesome. And I could feel how strong the bond was there. And at the same meeting, Barry announced his vision to go to the Christian flag instead of the big back patch. Z-Man was crushed. And I was crushed for him. And I said, well, I'm just going to wear this one, because I like the big one. I said, man, I still have it. I cherish it. It's in my case. If any of you know my house, I have a museum there in that case. And I still have my teddy bear in there. You know, I keep stuff, right, Sister Jillian? You know, that big patch is in there. And I was offended for him, because I knew that had to crush his feelings, and it did crush his feelings. It crushed him, and so I was thinking about it. I said, well, we'll just start our own. I remember I sent him a fax one time. This tells you how long it was ago, of a little drawing, and said, we'll just make our own. And I put like a skull with crosses coming out of the skull, and we'll just be the Iron Men, you know, or something like that. You know, iron sharpens iron. You know, well, he goes, ooh, that looks a little rough. I said, I'll just wear this, and I'm not going to change. And he said, well, that wouldn't be right to that man's ministry. That's his stuff. You know, it's his vision. But, you know, kept on going through. It's the same, you know, the same thing. We've had person after person. The last international president that stepped down, he started his own, and he called it Surviving Saints, because of the wrong offense. You know, he started out of the offense of how he's going to hold on to, and then it's offended brothers, or it's you get the picture. These are bikers. They get their feelings hurt.
Right.
Okay, I'm going to ask for one moment of clarity. If you are a biker and you ever got your feelings hurt, just raise your hand. Okay, look around, people. Look around. Okay, all right, now you can put them down. Now, I thank you for that. Now, those of you that weren't quite honest, we'll have an altar service. Because I'll tell you, every single one of you,
amen.
Church people included, it's a battle. It's a battle.
Right.
Harder to be won than a strong city. So, the Bible doesn't get us there, or get us to a problem and just leave us with a problem.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
And so I wanted to kind of remedy this, and maybe it will help you, because how to deal with offense could be a year-long Christian education program. Right? Because it would address everybody who's been hurt by church, or been something the pastor said, something the preacher said, something that I used to believe that I can't quite believe, something that somebody did, something. And what it does, it puts you in a very difficult spot. I want us to back up to the verse before the problem. And I've missed this verse in the 20-some-odd years of ministry. I missed it as a key, but I want to share it with you, and hopefully you'll gain something from it today that'll help you in your walk. Because I have learned not to get as offended as I once did.
Right. Come on.
I can remember very early on, I said, man, I'm going to have to be like Teflon. You know, nothing sticks to me. You know what I mean? Armored. You know, I want to have on a real armor. When you see that little armor, the armor of God, we like to talk about that. It's a defensive position that you're not going to get hurt. And so I came up with a word, unoffendable. I'm going to be unoffendable. Why? Because it goes way back, right? I see you, Tom. A chrome letter. President we have in the ministry a long time ago, he sent out this letter, and it was very offensive. He had no people skills, and he said basically in the letter, you can buy chrome for your motorcycle, but you can't send in $20 for a newsletter. And he sent it out to the whole ministry, even some that had never got the newsletter.
Oops.
And Tom took a piece of chrome paper and wrote him a letter telling him what he had done with the letter that he had wrote. Right? It goes way back. I mean, we're bikers, but hey, we have feelings. So I realized that I had to do something with my feelings. Whether you call it deadening the nerve endings of my feelings or whatever you call it, I've galvanized myself against offense. And so it takes quite an event to really get through any kind of chink in my armor to get an arrow to pierce my soul, because I've galvanized myself in the Lord, because He's able to do exceedingly abundantly above what we can even imagine. And so I imagine the Lord being able to galvanize me against offense to the point where that I don't have to worry about it. I don't have to worry about what the tale bearer says, and the tale bearer is in this chapter. I don't have to worry about what gossip says. If my ways are pleasing to the Lord, the Bible says that even a man's enemies can be at peace with him.
Right.
And so there'll be less offense if a man's ways please the Lord.
Right.
But there's going to be people who try to offend you, and the enemy will try to offend you on purpose to make you quit or think, oh, well, I better start my own, or, oh, I better go and do something else, or, oh, this or oh, that. Well, this scripture gives a little bit of a lighthearted effect, and I want to try to explain it to you the best I can. The 18th verse says, the lot causeth contentions to cease, and parteth between the mighty. Good men have disagreements. Amen?
Right.
Doesn't mean you're a bad man. Me and Z-Man have had some disagreements. I remember one officer's meeting. We were sitting in a big square in a square room all the way around, and we started arguing about the patches, right? HeavenSaints.com. And, you know, Z-Man was in one corner. In this corner was Z-Man. In this corner, I was in the other corner. And he said something I didn't like. And I said, well, if I come over and jump on you, you'll like it. And it doesn't end there, and you know, and I'm lighthearted with it now. You know, if you ever hear me say Tennessee Toho, you know that I'm getting serious. Because what comes out in this is the physical part. You know, I want to make somebody understand, right? Yeah, I had a disobedient child in the congregation one time, and we used to have this little thing we do called milk the mouse. And that's when you get somebody's pinky and you pinch it backwards to the point where they're going, oh, 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 oh. And I said, tell me you love me, tell me you love me, tell me you love me. My dad did it to me. And he did, but that happened from football. Right, Joey? Is Joey here? Where's Joey at?
Nursery.
He's got one just like it. We try to physically fix things that we can't fix. When two good men can't come to an agreement, you know, what's the solution for that? Our ministry wants to be faithful as a whole. The first year that we had new leadership under Brother Curtis, we had $17,000 surplus when we had been running in the red forever. And so we decided that we should tie it on our increase. And so we decided that what we would do, we would tie it outside of the ministry so that we would bless somebody that couldn't even imagine that it was coming, and just send $1,000 or $2,000 or whatever that the amount was. And so when you get a bunch of spiritual leaders together and you ask, who should we bless? You guessed it. Everybody's got somebody to bless. And to them, everybody is just as important to them as well. And so it was about the time that Anita Kay was going to Africa. And for those of you on a local level, what a wonderful testimony that this young girl, 17, 18, 19 years old, going to Africa as a missionary on her own. And then on the last time saying, I want a one-way ticket there. I said, well, that's a worthy cause. That's a worthy cause. And I wanted that. I wanted that with all my heart. I wanted the tithe of the Heaven Saints International go to an African missionary. Well, there's other worthy causes too.
Right.
And we blessed worthy causes over the year. One little church in, what was it, Mobile, Alabama, that their church was needing some intervention. They had no idea what was coming. I don't even think we had any saints there. It was just somebody knew that they needed a touch.
Right.
And so it was a beautiful thing. And so how do we come to an agreement with who we bless? Should we divvy it up, cut the baby? You know, no. You know what we did? I said, here's what we'll do. We'll put the names in a hat. And at that juncture, you know, there was only less than a half a dozen people that had gotten the idea, because this was like one of the first times we did it. And so it was just a few names in the hat, and I shook the hat up and had somebody draw it out. And guess which name come out of that hat? Anita Kay. Yeah, that's right. I felt, wow, I was right. See? See? And then you know what happened? People started saying,
please.
Wait a second. Let me see the rest of those lips.
Do they all say
it? Do they all say Anita Kay? Who wrote these lips? Who picked that slip? That's what they said. It was a God thing. Praise God.
Amen.
We presented it to her over at the district convention over in Tampa, and what a blessing that was.
Yeah.
But the good men disagreed on how we got to the final straw, so what we did is we drew straws. You say, well, Brother Scott, that's kind of silly. Apparently, it's not that silly. Did you know that the 12th disciple to take Judas's place was decided by the drawing of the straw or the casting of the lot? And this is what it's talking about, the lot. Okay, and so what I want to take you to is this scripture right here, this 18th verse, this chapter that is packed with wisdom that you said, amen, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. This same scripture, the other verses, they contain in-depth wisdom that we just might not have scratched. I've been ministering for 20 years plus, and I'd never really gathered this, but this morning I looked at this scripture, and it said the lot. And when I saw the lot, I was like, the lot of contentions, the lot of ground, the lot of what? A lot of what? That's what I was asking myself. But what this is talking about is like casting a die. Right. And what I mean by that is seven come eleven. Now, if you play dice, don't ask the Lord to bless your dice game. I got in trouble for pitching pennies when I was in elementary school. I don't know if you ever pitched pennies, but what we do is stand away from the wall, and then we would pitch pennies towards the wall, and whoever got the penny closest to the wall got to keep the pennies. Well, I had a pocket full of pennies when Miss Ruby showed up. Miss Ruby was lunch lady that had a paddle. That was back when discipline was very real. Someone strike the fear of God in any young person. And it worked. I didn't pitch pennies in that hallway anymore. The rod of correction drove that desire far from me. But everybody wants to win, right? You know who I'd like to meet? The guy that came up with heads I win, tails you lose. That's the guy I'd like to meet. right? Or how about this one? Okay, how about 2 out of 3? You beat me this time, but come on, let's go again. All right. The lot in this scripture is talking about a divine chance. And I know it's going to sound kind of crazy, but what about if we as brothers love one another so much that when we had some type of disagreement, we say, okay, let's draw straws.
Right.
And you know what would happen? The way that the depths that we descended to the basest sort of relationship is so far beneath what the Lord has called us to do is loving one another. What we would do is we wouldn't accept the decision.
Right.
What if I said, Brother Bucky, me and you disagree on this, let's flip a coin. Heads I win, tails you lose. Tails it is. Sorry. Oh, let me see that. Look at that now.
Is that a two-sided?
No, there's the heads. Look at that. Two-sided coin. Let's flip that one. What if when we had disagreement, it was as simple as, okay, that the love of Christ that we shared with one another was so supreme that our desire or our opinion or our offense didn't matter more than our brotherhood. Mm. What if we were to maintain that fellowship despite disagreements that the enemy tries to sow in? And then let me tell you, your thoughts sometimes aren't your thoughts.
Right.
And it happens in the chiefest of friends. If you look at Jesus and his disciples, after that they had been together for years, Jesus looked at Peter one day and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." That's his friend. His brother.
Right.
The fellow that he would end up saying, "Blessed are you." Because Peter didn't go away at the offense. He was like, did I just have a thought that was not good? And he had a thought that was not good. Because
right.
What Jesus was trying to tell him was truth. And what he was trying to do is protect Jesus. Because he knew better.
Right.
If we would take the thought, maybe we don't know better, as the seasoning of everything that we did, how would that change our perception of everybody else? How would that mend our fences? How would that go towards winning the offended brother? The Bible says here that a brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city. And their contentions are like the bars of a castle. If you know anything about a castle construction, a castle is built to be a fortification, but it can become a prison. Because as well as keeping everybody out, which is what we do very well and what we've been designed to do, we don't want to get hurt, so we keep everybody out.
Right.
We keep everybody at a distance. We don't want anybody to know our business and find out that you smoke dope, and then they won't like you anymore. You know. Who was that? No, I'm just kidding. Get his name, Paul. I went to visit a friend. He'd been coming to church for a while. And he wasn't expecting a pastoral visit because it had probably never happened before. And so when I knocked on the door, I knew there was an issue. I heard some rumblings about it in the living room. And when he answered the door, he was like, "Brother Scott," man, he had the door crack. Like, it's like he was naked or something, you know? I said, "Come on, man, you got clothes on. Let me in. What's the deal?" So I opened the door, and I know what marijuana smells like. I had been wanting him to help us on at church. I knew he could play music, and he'd been coming. His daughter had come to the altar and given her heart to the Lord. And so I sat down on the couch, and I was talking to him, and we were talking about the Lord. And my eyes fell down to the floor underneath the couch where the rolling tray goes. Is this too much information?
Used to go.
And so while we were talking about church and good things, and oh, yes, 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 oh, yes. I had my Bible with me. I reached down under the couch that he was sitting on, and I pulled the tray out into the middle of the living room floor, and then I set my Bible down beside it, and I turned it to where Joshua said, "Choose this day whom you will serve."
Amen.
And he was like this, because he was high. He was I would like to tell you that he chose the right way, and he was here, and he was a deacon and an elder in the church. Not so. Nope. The grip was too great for him to break. And I offended him. And his offense became like a strong castle. Except it really wasn't keeping the bad out, it was keeping him in.
Right. Yeah.
He was imprisoned by his imaginations of what I thought about him. I didn't think bad about him. I mean, I've been there, done that type of deal. I got rid of the t-shirt so nobody would know. Wasn't that I hated him, but the Lord died for us while we were yet sinners. But he took that offense, and it became his jail cell rather than his castle.
Come on.
When your castle becomes your jail cell. Because in offense, you know, I use this extreme offense because we get offended at the least little things.
Right.
And then we retreat inside of our castle, and we hold on to the bars as if everybody else is against us and we're not coming out to play.
Right. That's right.
Warriors.
Come out and play.
Warriors. Right. Have to come out of the castle at some point in time.
That's right.
You might be a damsel in distress up in your castle, but warriors come out and play.
Right.
Woo! Yes, amen. Amen. Is this okay? Yeah. I think it's time that the train left Offendedville.
Come on. That's right.
Can we do that? Can we do that? Amen. Now, what kind of a people would we have if we were void of offense? The Bible says in James that the man that offends not in word, the same is a perfect man.
Come on.
Ladies? You want to find a good man? Find someone who knows how to hold his tongue. That blesses rather than curses. His price is far above rubies. Same thing, guys. Turn with me to my final scripture in Psalms, the 119th chapter. And this is what I use for my unoffendable approach. Because it's scripture and it's so good. So much better than just my ideal. You know what I mean? I can have some bright ideals. But this one is a good scripture. The Bible says in the 165th verse of the 119th chapter of Psalms, "Great peace have they which loveth thy law, and nothing." "Shall offend them."
Amen.
Brother Scott, how do I get to that town?
Come on.
Amen. Jerusalem.
Come on.
Zion. The place of peace.
Come on.
Place of peace is found in the Lord. The remedy for our ills is found in the Lord. Offense is a weapon that the enemy uses to separate the chiefest of brethren. But if we can really get a grasp on what the enemy is trying to do, we can array our forces against what he's trying to do. And not only get in a defensive position, but I want to get in an offensive a position.
Right.
I was teaching some young high school boys yesterday, and I made an impact on them that they'll never forget. That's right. Amen. before I had left the building, Shiloh had already got 3 or 4 texts from kids she went to camp with. Said, "Your dad is nuts." What happened is, you know, they're kids, they're high school boys, and they got all kinds of issues. Right? And so what I did, I realized that they got all kinds of issues, but they got this image of the suit and tie preacher that can't touch or doesn't know where they've been. And so I try to give them a little, "I've been there, man," but they don't believe that. You know?
Right.
So I showed them. At one point in time, I said, "You got this image of Jesus where he's flowing robes and comes up and he says, 'Bless you, my son.'" I said, I want to give you a different image." And I reached over, and there's an 8-foot folding table there with a tablecloth on it. I took it with one hand, and I said, "Wow!" And I flung that table in the air like Superman. You know, and the table did the perfect belly flop. And the legs come up in the air, and it's a bam! And these kids are, "Oh!" There's another round table there behind me. I said, "Phew!" You know, with one hand, I threw this table across the room and it landed back behind me. And then I was getting the groove on. You know, I picked up an empty chair in the front row and I said, "Woo!" And threw it about 5 rows back into the crowd right where there's an empty spot of chairs. And I was just fixing to grab a child. I got a check in my spirit. You know, they're all fun and games until somebody gets hurt, right? They're in another class and another youth conference, another guy telling them about Jesus and what they should be like. And when they go home, they're going to be doing the exact same thing they always done, unless somebody shows up that's different.
Right.
And so for the motorcycle ministry in the local church here, our local church is becoming more and more galvanized against offense.
Amen.
Than what we've ever been before.
Right.
Things
right.
are going better this year than they ever have before.
Amen.
And we're not ignorant of his devices. And boy, it just rolls and it just rolls and it just rolls. And I want to share that a little bit with the motorcycle ministry, because our church is making gains and headway by recognizing what the enemy tries to do in brotherhoods.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
it takes a big man, a strong woman. I didn't say big woman. No, sad. I didn't say big woman. Somebody put
that was a beard check, right?
Don't laugh, don't point, don't look. It takes a big man to say, "You know, I know we disagree. Let's draw straws.
That's right.
Let's flip a coin." Where is Kyle? Kyle working with the kids. There he is. I may not get the story exactly right, and I'm sure this kind of shocked him coming from a pastor or whatever, but he had been coming to church rather faithfully, and he was growing.
Right.
Wednesday night Bible study, Sunday morning Sunday school, Sunday morning church. He was growing, and he was maturing. And his life had taken a turn on the upswing. He had a good pray-through session at the men's conference. And man, he was really feeling encouraged.
Right.
And was gaining ground. And then the devil offered him... No. Then he got free hockey tickets from a guy that he was trying to win. Right? Is that something like that?
Right.
Free hockey tickets like ringside, you know, or whatever. But
ringside.
Okay. Does that satisfy you? Okay. The things that will offend some people. One little letter, G. And it was on a Wednesday night. And so he called me. He said, "Brother Scott, I want to come to church, but there's this guy at work that I've been trying to win, and he offered me hockey tickets or something like that. And I wondered whether I should go to the hockey game to try to win the loss, or whether I should come to Bible study." I said, "Daddy, what you do? Flip a coin." would have expected that answer? You know what answer you would have got? What answer would you expect from a pastor? Know what you need to do. You know, I know you're just using this as an excuse to go to the Viking game. No. What would you have expected? And I felt good about it because I want to win the lost. And I know you have to go where they're at to win them, per se. And I knew that I believed his motive was semi-pure. And so I said, flip a coin. Hockey won. I don't know if he went for 2 out of 3. But how simple was that?
Right.
How difficult do we make things when they don't have to be difficult?
That's right.
And imagine if a lot could. Look what it says about this. It says that it could make that big a difference. Where the contentions would just go away.
Right.
You say, okay, we disagree. Let's flip a coin.
That's good.
And then I'll be satisfied with that.
Amen. That's good.
One last thing that I'll share, and I know I've gone too long for a Biker Sunday. What if we did that? What if we operated on it's not that big a deal? Offense in the Bible really is when you make someone stumble and lose their relationship with Christ.
Mm.
That's an offense. And that's when Jesus said, offenses are going to come, but woe unto them by which the offenses come. That's different than what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a difference of opinion, contentions about your way versus my way versus what it should be. And so I'm talking about two different things. I don't want anybody to be offended to the point where they lose out in their relationship with Christ.
That's right.
And you know, and if that happens, the Bible says it would be better that a millstone be hung around your neck than for you to offend one of these little ones that are to hurt them. And I don't want that to happen. What I do want to happen is I want us to bind together with something that is greater than being offended. Don't stay in the castle long.
Come on.
Forgiveness is a great key. Open the gate.
Yeah.
Let the King of Glory come in. Who is the King of Glory?
Come on.
He's great, strong, mighty. He'll give you peace like you've never known. By simply rolling the dice. I don't know if I'd do it that way. This must be 2 dice or 1? When I was a kid, we had this thing called the Crazy 8-Ball. And for those of you who may not have been around that time, it was like a polymer plastic ball, and it had liquid on the inside, and on the inside of the liquid ball, it had a triangle with various answers on it, or a square, I can't remember. And you would shake it up, you would ask the ball a question, and you would shake it up and say, should I go out with her? And then there was a little window inside the ball, and the little answer would come up through the juice and say, ask again later. How much later? And it would say, yes, no, maybe. I can't even remember that. That would be a good trivia question. What were the answers on the Crazy 8-Ball? A lot of people treat their relationship with the Lord like that.
Right.
Gideon.
Right.
Knew he had heard from an angel of the Lord, knew he'd been visitation, but he didn't believe the word per se. And he was like, is anybody else up there I can talk to? Can I get a second opinion on that? Let me put a fleece out and see if it'll be wet and the ground not be wet or vice versa. And he did it twice. So 2 out of 3 ain't bad. But he got the answer that he needed both times, and so 2 out of 3 was there. What if it were that simple?
Hmm. That's right.
Is your love for one another strong enough for it to be that simple? Is the recipe for success in the Word of God clear enough that if you meditate upon the laws of the Lord day and night, that your life can be different. If your delight is in the law of the Lord, is it such a stretch to believe that an almighty God can soothe the offenses and contentions that come in this world? One last question. Will you leave here offended? Would you stand with me?